Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Without you, now I'm lonely. Good morning. Welcome to Ames United Methodist Church. We're glad you're here online with us this morning, and we hope that you will continue to find us a helpful way to worship, to gather together as we shelter in. And our prayers are that we'll get through this season soon, and we can gather together back as a fellowship. We continue to invite you to make connection with Ames Church. Again, if you are on our email list, if you are on our mailing list, we send out a reminder of our service schedules and a connection card that helps us connect with you. It gives us some information that we can share and we can connect during the week. We ask you to continue to look for the questions that go along with our message each week. Helps you to kind of sit back afterwards and maybe have a good discussion with a partner or a friend, whoever you're sheltering in with. And then also it allows us to hear those things that are going on in your life during the week. There's an opportunity for you to list some prayer concerns or just make some comments. And again, you can email those back to us at the church or give us a call. And we'll some way, shape, or form get back with you and make a connection. It matters to us what's going on in your life. Would you pray with me this morning, our opening prayer? Holy God, like those in the youth of their lives, we come to you with a young hope and a new faith still to mature in the reflection of your love. Through the promise of Easter, we walk with you in the midst of the complexities and ambiguities of life. We glimpse evidence of your care, our sustaining Creator. Help us to keep open the eyes of our hearts so we might keep a healthy balance between what is reality and what we hope for. In the strength of your care and in Christ we pray. Amen. Our first Bible reading this morning is from the New Testament book of Acts, the early church. And we're starting at Acts 2, 14, the first part of 14, and then we're going to hop down to verse 36. That's when Peter stood up and, backed by the other 11, spoke out with bold urgency. All Israel, then, know this. There's no longer room for doubt. God made him master and Messiah, this Jesus whom you killed on a cross. Cut to the quick, those who were listening asked Peter and the other apostles, Brothers, so now what do we do? Peter said, Change your life. Turn to God and be baptized, each of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so your sins are forgiven. Receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is targeted to you and your children, but also to all who are far away, whomever, in fact, our Master God invites. He went on this vein for a long time, urging them over and over. Get out while you can. Get out of this sick and stupid culture. That day, about 3,000 took him at his word, were baptized, and were signed up. They committed themselves to the teaching of the apostles, the life together, the common meal, and the prayers.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 holy. I want to see you.
This is an opportunity for you to worship God through your giving. And you will see on your screen various ways in which you can continue to send your support, your tithes, your offerings. I thank you for those who have been faithful, and I encourage you to keep on giving for the important ministries of this church. Please pray with me our offering prayer. God of truth and light, we offer you these gifts with humble hearts. We yearn to share your unmistakable presence with all people. While we often find temporary security in our possessions, remind us that true security comes from our relationship with you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Strengthen and entrust us to be your faithful disciples. In the name of the Exalted One, we pray. Amen. Our second Bible reading is a psalm. And again, psalms are poetry. They're songs. They're cries out to God. They're excitement. And they show us and give us an opportunity for a proper response to God's calling to us, God in our lives. This is Psalm 116, verses 1 through 4 and 12 through 19. I love God because he listened to me, listened as I begged for mercy. He listened so intently as I laid out my case before him. Death stared me in the face. Hell was hard on my heels. Up against it, I didn't know which way to turn. Then I called out to God for help. Please, God, I cried out, save my life. What can I give back to God for the blessings he's poured out on me? I'll lift high the cup of salvation, a toast to God. I'll pray in the name of God. I'll complete what I promised God I'd do, and I'll do it together with his people. When they arrive at the gates of death, God welcomes those who love him. Oh God, here I am, your servant, your faithful servant. Set me free for your service. I'm ready to offer the thanksgiving sacrifice and pray in the name of God. I'll complete what I promised God I'd do, and I'll do it in company with his people, in the place of worship, in God's house in Jerusalem, God's city. Alleluia. We go to a time of prayer, and we did get a few Connect cards back last week and had a few prayer requests, but the great people that you are, it wasn't for specific things, it wasn't for specific needs, but more for God to take control of this COVID-19 situation, for God to bless and bring us all back together in our churches and places of worship. And we want to keep our brother, sister, churches in this community in prayer as well. We're all in this together, as we hear time and time again on the news, and we honor all people who are believers and seek to be in fellowship with Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Let's go together to a time of prayer. You amaze us, Holy God. We fail ourselves, we disappoint others, and we let you down. Still, you witness the ways we live that have had disastrous effects on others and ourselves, and you choose to love rather than to destroy us. You seek no revenge for our killing Jesus daily by the way we live. Help us to accept ourselves, to accept each other, and to change our ways so that they might more closely approximate your hopes for us. We worship you, God, who has the power to heal, to forgive the sinner, and to inspire our faith. We cherish your approval of us as your created beings. We continually fall short, yet glean from your acceptance the energy to try to live the best lives we can. Lord of the church, we pray for members of your church who seem to have forgotten they are members. While praying for them, keep us from being judgmental or smug. Move us rather to ask ourselves probingly, are we perhaps responsible for their absence? Have we been neglect in our ministry to them? Have we failed in whatever measure to be truly caring, nurturing, to be community for them? Cause your Spirit so to work both in them and in us that they may be moved to return to our worship and our shared life. Then help us together as your church in this place and in this city to be a showcase of what life and community can be like when you are in control. We offer this prayer in your powerful name, and we pray together now the prayer that you've taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Before I read our third Bible lesson for today, I want to give you a brief introduction to our message, in that I've entitled it, Do You See Jesus in Life's Journey? And it's part of a series that we've been going together through during this Easter season, where we look at hope versus doubt. So do you see Jesus in the life's journey? As I have a conversation with you today, I will be reading parts of the Bible lesson. It'll be broken up. It won't all be at one time. So we find ourselves recently, the governor of Michigan has extended our sheltering in for at least 2 more weeks, given us a date in May, and we've heard from Bishop Bard, our United Methodist bishop for the Michigan area, and he has recommended that we follow that. And our Bible says that we need to follow the laws of our land and to pray for our government. And so as we move forward, yes, we're disappointed. We had hoped that the end of the month would bring us back together, but we also understand there's a reality to the seriousness of the situation, and if we can do some things that will save a few more lives, that will make us healthier and a better community, and give some time to have scientists and doctors and the folks that are working on all of the dynamics of this situation some more time. And overall, we do this for the care of people, then it'll be worth it. So our Bible story today is entitled "The Walk to Emmaus," and it's a story of a couple of the followers of Jesus, a couple of the disciples who take a walk towards the town of Emmaus, sometime after Jesus has died on the cross and been resurrected, and some folks have already experienced the living Christ, the resurrected Christ in their presence. And so as two of these followers walk towards the city, or the town, the village of Emmaus, and they're walking. They don't have a donkey or a horse or modern times, contemporary times. We walk very little, except during the sheltering in time. More and more people have been taking some walks in the neighborhood and slowing down a little bit. It's not quite as easy to just jump in a car and go here and there and everywhere like we've been accustomed to. As they're traveling together, they're talking and they're joined by a third party. And so this third party starts to walk with them, and they enter into a conversation. We'll be hearing it read from our Bibles in just a bit, and the third person that joins is the risen Christ, and so he begins to have a conversation with folks, and so we'll kind of take it from there. We're going to read this account from Luke's Gospel, book of Luke, at the 24th chapter, beginning at verse 13. And again, I'll be reading from the paraphrase, The Message. And The Message is a Bible in contemporary language. And it speaks to me. You might have another favorite translation or version, and that's okay. But in Luke 24, verse 13, that same day, two of them were walking to the village Emmaus, about 7 miles out of Jerusalem. They were deep in conversation, going over all these things that had happened. In the middle of their talk and questions, Jesus came up, walked along with them, but they were not able to recognize who he was. He asked, "What's this you're discussing so intently as you walk along?" They just stood there, long-faced, like they had lost their best friend. Then one of them, his name was Cleopas, said, "Are you the only one in Jerusalem who hasn't heard what's happened during the last few days? He said, what has happened? I'm going to stop there. I want you to go on a walk. I want you to think of a time. I want you to hope for a time, maybe in the next 2 weeks, where this sheltering in ban has been lifted, and we're finally going to have an opportunity to go back to our church, to our building. Our church is the verb, remember. Our church is the ministry. Our church is the people. But you're actually, you know, maybe you live close enough by that you're out and you're taking a walk and you're excited. I want you to think, what are you excited about? What's different? What's happened? And so as you walk along, you have hopefully during this time made a new friend. Maybe you've been reacquainted with a neighbor. Maybe you have remembered about this Everything Has Become New card that we started way back at the beginning of the Lenten season, and you wrote a name on there, and you've been praying for that person. We were going to celebrate and try to invite those people or that person on Easter Sunday, and then we sheltered in place. So hopefully you've been continuing to pray, and you have had an opportunity to keep in contact by phone or email or however else that you contact. And so now the two of you are coming to church together. And maybe you're a person that doesn't walk, and so you need to drive. And so you're driving to church, but you're bringing this friend, this person that you've been praying for and you've invited. So what are you going to be talking about? What are you going to be telling them about the church? In our classes where we talk about hospitality and how we want to really roll out the red carpet for our guests, our special guests that we invite, there's some techniques. And one of the things that we are reminded of is we don't just call somebody up on the phone and say, hey, we'd really like you to come to our church building and come to worship and then just kind of leave it at that. No, we see if they need a ride, see if they like to walk with us. And if they say, well, I'll just meet you there, don't say, well, I'll wait for you inside. You say, hey, how about I meet you in the parking lot? I'll meet you in the parking lot. We can walk in together. And you make sure that you get rid of any kind of stumbling blocks, because this is important stuff. So what is your walk going to feel like? What is it going to look like? What is it going to sound like? What are you going to tell people? Because, folks, there are going to be some people that you really invite and you really pray for, and they say, hey, you've been out of your building for the last however many weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks. What difference does it make? Why should I? I've gotten by fine. And why should I start now? That's a question that we have to be prepared. We have to know what we're going to talk about. Are we the only people that don't know what's happened? Not only in the last few days, but over this Easter season? Let's continue on with our Bible reading. He said, what has happened? They said the thing that happened to Jesus, the Nazarene. He was a man of God, a prophet, dynamic in work and word, blessed by both God and all the people. Then our high priests and leaders betrayed him, got him sentenced to death and crucified him. And we had our hopes up that he was the one about to deliver Israel. And it is now the third day since it's happened. But now some of our women have completely confused us. Early this morning, they were at the tomb and couldn't find his body. They came back with the story that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Some of our friends went off to the tomb to check and found it empty, just as the women had said. But they didn't see Jesus. Then he said to them, so thick-headed, so slow-hearted, why can't you simply believe all that the prophets said? Don't you see that these things had to happen, that the Messiah had to suffer and only then enter into his glory? Then he started at the beginning with the books of Moses and went on through all the prophets, pointing out everything in the scriptures that refer to him. We're going to pause again. We'll come back to the rest of this scripture, to this story. There's a couple of stories that I want us to think about. They're not notable Christian stories. One is a children's story. I heard it from my parents or grandparents or somebody when I was just a little guy. It's called Goldilocks and the Three Bears. Anybody else ever heard that story? Goldilocks and the Three Bears. This character, Goldilocks, little girl, goes for a walk in the woods, and she gets lost after a while, and she's tired, and she's hungry, just like some of us who are lost in the world, and we're tired. We've lost all hope, and we're hungry. We hunger for the Word of God. We hunger for honest-to-goodness conversation. We hunger for friendship. We hunger and thirst for caring people. She goes into the, she finds a cabin and knocks at the door, and nobody answers, and she goes in, and the story goes, you know, first she finds some porridge that's sitting on the table, and there's a big bowl, belongs to Papa Bear, and a medium-sized bowl that belongs to Mama Bear, and a little bowl that belongs to Baby Bear, and she goes through and tests them and tastes them. She finds that Baby Bear's bowl of porridge is just right. It's not too hot, it's not too cold, it's not too big, it's just right. And she eats that. Let's go back to your walk or your drive to church, and you're bringing a guest in. And you haven't been in your building for the last 6 weeks. What are you going to do? Are you going to rush in and see if somebody's been sitting in your pew? Has somebody been using your hymnal or singing your song? Or are you going to put your guest first? Welcome your guest. For those of you that know the story of Goldilocks and the Three Bears, the three bears come home and find Goldilocks sleeping upstairs after she's tried some chairs and then gone up and found a bed. And each time she really likes the smaller chair and the smaller bed that belong to Baby Bear. But as they're standing there, and Baby Bear says, look, Mom, somebody's sleeping in my bed, and there she is. And Goldilocks wakes up. She is frightened. the bears frighten her, and she runs out, and she's safe as far as we know, but that's the end of the story. What are we gonna tell folks as we walk to the church? What are we gonna share with them? What's important? There's another story. It's been, I believe it's a classic. It's in writing. It's been made into movies or YouTubes. It's called The Prince and the Pauper. And it's a story of two individuals, two young boys. They're in maybe 12, 13 years old. They're beginning or early teens. And one is a prince in a big palace. The other is a poor child who wanders around each day, tries to find something to eat, but has lots of adventure, lots of excitement out in his day-to-day living. The prince is kept in the castle and has to go through the motions of learning to be a prince. He has to wear clothes that are uncomfortable and do things that are tradition and always act and behave, and he's bored. Somehow these, in the story, the two boys who look alike, and one's a prince and one's a pauper, have an opportunity to change places. And so now the poor boy is brought into the palace, and the prince finds himself out with all the protection, and yet he finds a freedom, and he finds excitement, and he finds opportunity, and so this pauper, this boy that's been poor all along, has an opportunity to be the prince. He eats well, he's dressed up, and he even gets to a point where he gets to make decisions, life decisions, that impact other people, that impact the common folk who are under the reign of the king and the prince to be, who will be the new king. And in this poor boy, this pauper, starts to make really sound decisions, really fair decisions, really decisions that help people because of his prior experience. And it's a great story. It's a great family story, but it teaches us. It teaches us to think about, what if we have to walk in another person's shoes to live another person's life? And I think that those are good things to think about as we hope for this end to the COVID-19, but we come back to our buildings and we come back to our ministries, we come back to what we're doing, we really need to have a plan. We really need to look, we really need to, that song we sang, "Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord," we really need to look into our hearts and say, hey, what have we gleaned from this situation? And how are we going to use what we learned? Well, let's go on with our Bible story. Don't you see that these things had to happen, that the Messiah had to suffer and only then enter into his glory? Then he started at the beginning with the books of Moses and went through all the prophets, pointing out everything in the scriptures that referred to him. They came to the edge of the village where they were headed. He acted as if he were going on, but they pressed him, "Stay and have supper with us. It's nearly evening. The day is done." So he went with them. And here is what happened. He sat down at the table with them. Taking the bread, he blessed and broke and gave it to him. At that moment, open-eyed, wide-eyed, they recognized him. And then he disappeared. Back and forth they talked. Didn't we feel on fire as he conversed with us on the road, as he opened up the scriptures for us? They didn't waste a minute. They were up and on their way back to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and their friends gathered together, talking away. It's really happened. The master has been raised up. Simon saw him. Then the two went over everything that happened on the road and how they recognized him when he broke the bread. So what about us? What's going to happen on our road, on our trip, on our walk back to our building? What are we going to tell folks? What are we going to tell folks about this COVID-19 situation? Was it an opportunity? Did anything good come out of it? What difference does Christ make in your life and in my life when he opens our eyes, when he opens our hearts? If you could have a conversation with a non-believer, what will you tell him or her about the COVID-19 trial? What has happened to you? What change has God made in your faith, in your life, and in your belief? What will you do when your eyes are open? I invite you to be in a spirit of prayer with me. Holy God, we give you thanks for an opportunity to be your called people. We give you thanks for an opportunity to have had the privilege, to have had some of us Sunday school classes and vacation Bible schools and opportunities for learning about your prophets, about your scriptures, about your seeking us, calling us, about your dying on the cross for our sins and rising again so that we might be redeemed and saved. And we give you thanks. We ask you, Lord, to open our eyes, open our ears, open our voices so that we might share with others the good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Closing song today is an old hymn or an old popular song called Just a Little Talk with Jesus. And as you hear that song played, I invite you to substitute talk with walk, just a little walk with Jesus, as you think about that day, whenever it's announced that we'll be able to have a walk back to our buildings, or Jesus calls us home, and it's just a little walk with Jesus as he invites us into his place and in heaven with him. But I invite you to think about that.
Well, I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. And then a little light from heaven filled my soul. Well, it bathed my heart in love. Talk with Jesus makes it right.
cloud of doubt may hide the light of day. The mist of sin may rise and hide the starry skies. But just a little talk with Jesus clears the way. Let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all about our troubles.
I'll receive the benediction in a blessing this morning. Blessed are you who go forth in the name of the Lord. May God strengthen you for every good work, that your efforts be well-pleasing in his sight. May God anoint you with power to live out your life in the faith that lives in your heart. May God grant you deep peace in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
There was a time that I swore I would never go back. I was blind to the truth, didn't know what I had. I was running, I was searching, but every place I turned for healing left me more broken than the last. Take me back to the place that feels like home, to the people I can depend on, to the faith that's in my bones. Take me back to a preacher and a verse where they see me at my worst, to the love I had at first. Oh, I wanna go to church. Tried to walk on my own, but I wound up lost. And now I'm making my way to the foot of the cross. It's not a trophy for the winners, it's a shelter for the sinners, and it's right where I belong. Take me back to the place that feels like home, to the people I can depend on, to the faith that's in my bones. Take me back to a preacher and a verse where they've seen me at my worst, to the love I had at first. Oh, I wanna go to church. I wanna go to church. Oh, it's our foundation, the
family of God. I know it's hard, but we need each other. We're sisters and brothers. Oh, take me back to the place that feels like home, to the people I can depend on, to the faith that's in my bones. Take me back to a preacher in a verse, where they've seen me at my worst, to the love I had at first. Oh, I wanna go to church. I wanna go to church. Take me back. I wanna go to church.